Namaskar. Dear learners, I welcome you to today's program of Krishnakanta Hendrik State Open University. I am Dr. Sukmaya Lama, Assistant Professor in the Department of History, and today I welcome you to this program. The topic of discussion today is India under the Gupta rule. This particular topic is meant for the first semester students pursuing BA in History. Let us begin with the topic of discussion today. The objective of our discussion today is to explain and understand as well as analyze the rise of Gupta power in India, their background, and the expansion and consolidation of the Gupta Empire, the polity and administration under the Guptas, and the factors leading to its downfall. The Gupta age has been described by the historians as one of the most era of what they say is of golden era. It is said that because of the impressive achievement it had achieved in the field of literary and art scenario. Let us move on to understand what was the background or what was the origin of the Guptas. There are lack of sources, or there are very limited sources when you try to understand the origin of the Guptas. There are different theories that have been put forward by the historians, and for some of the historians, they say that they were rulers of a small principality in Magadha, while others say that they had a base in the western Gangetic plain. There are again others who say that their name itself indicates that they were from the Vaishya community, but then again others accord them with the status of the Brahmana. Records like the Vakataka records or the Gupta records or even Yi Tsing or the Chinese traveler mentions two earliest Gupta rulers by the name of Sri Gupta and Ghatotkacha. However, what we know is this, that it was only during Chandragupta I that the Gupta Empire started to make its presence felt in the Indian scenario. What we see that it was because of his matrimonial alliances with the princess of the Lichhavi family, which proved to be very favorable in terms of political expansion and the claim to power and acceptability. Chandragupta I rule, his rule extended over Magadha, Saketa and Prayaga. He was succeeded by his son Samudragupta in and around 335 AD, and there is a eulogy, or the Allahabad Prashasti actually tells us that his accession to the throne was somehow very, very mysterious. It seems that he had a rival to the throne and he had to overcome his rival. Coins of an obscure prince by the name of Kacha was found, and this itself is an evidence that Samudragupta had to fight his way to the throne. Samudragupta started his career of expansion, and we can say that it was during this period, during the time of Samudragupta, that the expansionist policy of the Guptas began. He started his expansion by subjugating the neighboring kings in the Ganga Yamuna valley, and he tried to consolidate his position at home before he started his campaign in the remote south. It was at that initial strokes that he defeated four important kings of modern UP and central India. They were Achyuta of Ahichhatra, the Nagasena of Mathura, and the prince of Kota family. Also the Ganapati Naga of Padmavata. His South Indian campaign was formulated with the theory of Dharma Vijaya, which was marked by the three principles, namely Grahana, which is the capture of the army, Moksha, liberation, and Anugraha, principle of favoring by reinstating the enemy. This particular policy is seen throughout his campaign, because what we understand is that he did conquer most of his territories, but the interest was more on submission and paying off tributes, rather than bringing the entire territory under his control. During the course of his campaign, Samudragupta defeated as many as 12 kings of South India, whom he first captured and then liberated and ultimately reinstated in their respective kingdoms. Probably when Samudragupta was busy in his campaigns in the south, some of the North Indian kings or the rulers took the opportunity of his absence and started rebelling against him. To deal with this matter, Samudragupta hurried back home and he conquered 9 of the hostile North Indian kings who had formed a confederacy among themselves to resist the power of the Guptas. Poet Harisena has made it very clear that Samudragupta not only defeated them but also uprooted them violently. Apart from these 3 campaigns in the north, we see that he also defeated some of the forest kings or the tribal chiefs of central India and Deccan. Along with that, 9 republics, including the age-old Mallavas, the Yodhayas and Madrakas, were forced to accept Gupta suzerainty. His victory over the tribals and the republican governments, however, proved to be very disastrous for the later Guptas, about which we will discuss again. Because we see that, you know, these kingdoms were actually working as a buffer state. But because of the Guptas' aggression, we see that in the later part of the Guptas, the Hunas started invading this particular Gupta empire, which ultimately led to its downfall. We also see that Samudragupta overran some of the independent or semi-independent foreign powers which went beyond his own frontier. For example, like the Daivaputra Shahi, Shahanushahi, Saka Murandas, etc. We also see that the king of Ceylon, Sri Lanka, maintained diplomatic relationships. We also know that the kings of Nepal, Punjab also gave tribute to the Gupta ruler. And what we see is that in the south, his hegemony under Samudragupta that I'm talking about reached up to the tract of Tamil Nadu. However, despite all this conquest made in this Indian subcontinent, the main area of his rule was much more limited around UP, Bihar, West Bengal and a portion of central province and Vindhya region. To commemorate his victory, Samudragupta performed the Ashwamedha sacrifice or the horse sacrifice, the performance of which is regarded in history as a symbol of imperialism. The next ruler who succeeded Samudragupta was his son Chandragupta II. But again, his rise to power is again shrouded in mystery because it's been in a play which was written by Vishakha Datta, Devi Chandraguptam. It is mentioned that Samudragupta was succeeded by his elder brother Ramagupta, who in his fight with the Sakas had to surrender his wife Dhruba Devi in return for his empire. Chandragupta II, the youngest brother, was very furious and it seemed that he heroically not only saved the queen but he also killed the Sakas. It is also said that he killed his elder brother and married Dhruba Devi. This particular, the authenticity behind this particular play is verified by the coins of Ramagupta and inscriptions mentioning Dhruba Gupta, Dhruba Devi actually, as the queen of Chandragupta II. The Guptas under Chandragupta II what we know is this, that by the time Chandragupta's reign was over, the empire had already expanded a lot, and the only part that was left to be conquered was the west. And we see that Chandragupta II had now taken upon him to march towards the west, that was against the Sakas. And his aim throughout was to isolate the Sakas, and for this he entered into matrimonial alliances. What we know of is this, that he himself married the Naga princess Kuvera Naga. In order to strengthen his position against the Sakas, he also married off his daughter to the Vakataka ruler. What happens now is this, that because of these alliances, he protected his empire and by isolating the Sakas from any future invasions. The conquest of Western India was a boon to the Gupta Empire because it opened the trade routes and expanded its boundary from the Bay of Bengal to the east to the Arabian Sea on the west. So what we understand is this, that till the time of Samudragupta, the policy was to expand the empire. And in times of during the time of Chandragupta II, what we understand is this, that he tried more or less to consolidate the empire that had been built by Samudragupta. Now, if we move on, we will try to look into the polity and the administrative system that was built by the Guptas. What we understand is that under the Gupta, the monarchy was advocated as the ideal system of government in the Gupta period. The Gupta emperors adopted the high-sounding titles of Maharaja Dhiraj and Parama Bhattaraka. The king was considered to be the supreme head of the government, and he was assisted by the crown princes and the council of ministers. Perhaps some of the high officers were hereditary and limited to a number of families only. Among the high officials in the central administration, mention may be made of Mahabalidhikrita, Mahadandanayaka, Mahapratihara, Mahakapati, etc. There were other class of officials called the Kumaramatyas and Ayuktas. They worked as a link between the central and provincial administration. When we talk of provincial administration, I must also mention here that the empire, which was so large, was divided in a number of provinces for administrative conveniences. The names of the provinces were mostly Bhuktis, Desas and Bhogas. The provinces were again subdivided into districts called the Vishayas. A part of the Vishaya was called Vithi. The villages or the grama were the lowest administrative units. The officers in charge of the administration at the provincial and the district level were mainly Uparikas, Vishayapatis, Kumaramatyas and Ayuktas. In case of judiciary or the judicial administration, we see that the Katyayana Smriti lays down the traditional way that the king was considered to be the highest judge, and he personally attended the courts to listen to cases. And he was assisted by the body of ministers, amatyas, that we say, judges or pradvivaka, and the Brahmins or the Purohitas. As far as the revenue administration goes, the main source of royal revenue were different type of land revenues, fines realized for offences, commercial taxes, and taxes on salt and mines. There were guilds or shrenis, which continued to flourish among the merchants and the artisans. The guilds or shrenis were autonomous, and the guilds were governed by their own laws. When we are talking of revenue administration, what I told you before was that land revenue was the main source of income for the state. This land revenue emerged because of the grant of lands during the time of the Guptas. And this was one of the reasons. This again leads to one of the causes for which the Gupta Empire had to meet its death. We now move on to the next topic, that is the downfall of the Guptas. One of the main reasons behind the downfall of the Guptas was the foreign invasion or the Hunna invasion. And this began during the time of Kumaragupta and in the later part during the time of Skandagupta. While both Kumaragupta and Skandagupta were able to resist the invasion of the Hunas, it became very difficult in the later part due to their weak successors, and as a result of which the continuous invasion of the Hunas led to the death knell of this Gupta Empire. The next would be the internal conflicts. We see that the breaking away of the feudatories of the Guptas was one of the major factors. One example could be the invasion of the Vakatakas. We also know, we have already discussed, that Chandragupta I himself had established friend relation with the Vakatakas. But the successor of Chandragupta II had no peaceful relation. In the reign of Buddha Gupta, the Vakataka king Narendra Sena invaded some of the central Indian region like Malwa, Kosala and Mekala. We also see that in subsequent years, another Vakataka king Harisena conquering Gujarat and Malwa. There are also other feudatories, like the rulers of Yashodharvan, inflicting a death blow to the Gupta Empire. Because of the decentralization policy of the Guptas, where some of the principalities were being allowed to rule independently, there was a rise of the feudal clans. And when they got the opportunity to attack the Gupta Empire, they lost no chance. And we see that this continuous conflicts and the rebellious nature of the feudatories led to the disintegration of the Gupta Empire. The next cause is the decentralization policy that again that I'm talking about. The provincial governors enjoyed a very, very good deal of freedom. As I talked about, the Gupta rulers failed to erect any kind of administrative machinery to keep a check on their high-handedness. The other element, the other reason what led to the downfall of the Guptas was the growth of feudal elements. What we see is this, that the Gupta rulers failed to pay cash salary to their official. In return, they granted land. And as a result of which, the officials developed a feudal character. They identified themselves only to their local interest in defiance of the central authority. And this growth of feudal elements further accelerated the process of the decentralization of the Gupta Empire. Now, these are some of the references or the books that you may go through in order to understand this particular topic. And before we wind up, let us go through the entire topic once again. What we discussed here today with you was the rise and fall of the Gupta Empire. So with this, I come to the end of this program today. Thank you very much.